Assalamu alaikum students, hope you are doing well. This is Dr. Haseeb. So today we are going to start regulation of respiration. This is the first of three lectures. So we are referring to chapter 42 of 13th edition of Galton's Physiology. So we will cover this chapter 42 in three sessions today, then the next on Tuesday, and we will finish this on Wednesday, inshallah. So by the end of today's session, inshallah, you may be able to enumerate the different respiratory control centers. Then we will compare the differences between the two important medullary centers, the dorsal respiratory group of neurons and the ventral respiratory group of neurons. Then we will discuss the difference between carotid body and carotid sinus, how respiration is regulated by different chemical factors, and at the end we will learn about the Herring-Breuer inflation reflex. So these are the learning objectives for today's session. Let's begin. So as far as our respiratory system is concerned, there are multiple factors that affect the respiratory centers, whether the centers are located within the medulla oblongata or in pons or even in the cerebral cortex. So these are the important factors that affect the respiratory centers. Obviously, the higher center, the cerebral cortex, is under voluntary control, and we can voluntarily control our breathing rate to certain extent with the help of signals from the higher centers, that is from the cerebrum. Then there are other factors like chemical factors and non-chemical factors that may affect the breathing rate, not only breathing rate, the tidal volume as well. For example, there are different types of chemoreceptors located within the brainstem. These are known as the central chemoreceptors. Moreover, there are other types of chemoreceptors located at the carotid sinus and carotid body. These are the peripheral chemoreceptors. Then we have the baroreceptors or the pressoreceptors. They may alter the breathing rate, respiration, or tidal volume. Stimuli from the stretch receptors located within the lungs, they may affect the respiratory centers as well. So these are the factors that may alter the breathing rate or the depth of tidal volume. Then the signals are sent to the spinal cord and eventually the respiratory muscles for the control of respiration. So as far as the regulation or control of respiration is concerned, we can classify the mechanisms into two broader categories: the nervous control and the chemical control. The nervous control is regulated by the medullary and pontine respiratory centers. So we have two medullary respiratory centers, dorsal respiratory group of neurons and ventral respiratory group of neurons. Both these centers are located within the medulla oblongata. Hence, they are known as the medullary respiratory centers. Then we have two pontine respiratory centers, one located in the lower pons, the other one in the upper pons. The one located in the lower pons is the apneustic center, and superior to the apneustic center is the pneumotaxic center. So both apneustic and pneumotaxic centers are collectively called as the pontine respiratory centers. So these four centers, two medullary and two pontine centers, these are the centers which maintain the nervous mechanism. Then we have the chemical control of respiration, and there are three important chemical stimuli for the regulation of respiration, and these three stimuli are partial pressure of oxygen, partial pressure of carbon dioxide, and the third one is hydrogen ion concentration or pH. So variation in any of these three stimuli may alter the respiration. So in broader category, we can classify the mechanisms as nervous or chemical. Here you can see the respiratory control centers located within the medulla oblongata and the pons. Remember the two medullary respiratory centers, the dorsal respiratory group of neurons, commonly denoted as DRG, and ventral respiratory group of neurons, VRG. So DRG and VRG are the medullary centers, and two pontine centers are there, apneustic and pneumotaxis center. These respiratory control centers are to a certain degree under the control of cerebral cortex. So we can voluntarily increase or decrease our breathing rate from signals from the higher centers. Besides the respiratory control centers located within the medulla oblongata and pons, there are certain chemoreceptors as well. And we can subdivide these chemoreceptors as central chemoreceptors located at the floor of fourth ventricle. And then we have peripheral chemoreceptors located at the peripheral arteries. These peripheral chemoreceptors are sometimes known as the arterial chemoreceptors, carotid and aortic peripheral chemoreceptors. So besides the conventional respiratory control centers located within the brainstem, there are chemoreceptors as well, and signals from these central and peripheral chemoreceptors, they stimulate or inhibit the medullary and pontine centers as well. Then we have other mechanoreceptors that are located inside the lung tissue, and these are known as the stretch receptors. So stretch within the lung tissue may alter the respiratory rate, and we can classify these mechanoreceptors as stretch receptors, J receptors, or irritant receptors. All are examples of touch receptors or mechanoreceptors. Then there are proprioceptors, which may alter the respiration. And these proprioceptors are located within the muscle, and they also send signal, whether excitatory or inhibitory, to the brainstem. Once the respiratory control centers located within the medulla and pons are activated, then the signals will be sent to the spinal motor neurons, and via the phrenic nerve, the signal will be transmitted to the diaphragm and other respiratory muscles for the control of respiration. So this is how respiration is regulated. This is the control of respiration. We can see the role of the voluntary center, that is the cerebral cortex. Then the respiratory control centers of medulla and pontine centers, they are at the center. And we have other receptors like chemoreceptors, whether central or peripheral, mechanoreceptors or proprioceptors. all may alter the breathing rate or tidal volume. So now we will discuss the basic anatomy, basic physiology of each of these respiratory control centers. We will start from the respiratory control centers located within the brainstem, that is medullary respiratory centers and pontine respiratory centers. Then we will discuss the physiology of chemoreceptors, both central and peripheral chemoreceptors. So this is the cut section of the brainstem. This is the brainstem here. And this is the amplified version of the same cut section. This is the medulla oblongata. This region is the pons. And we can divide the respiratory centers into two categories, the medullary respiratory center located within the medulla oblongata and pontine respiratory centers located inside the pons. The two major types of centers located inside the medulla oblongata are dorsal respiratory group of neurons and ventral respiratory group of neurons. And here you can see the location. This is the dorsal respiratory group of neuron located posteriorly or towards the dorsum, and on the ventral side is the ventral respiratory group of neuron. So collective term is the medullary respiratory center. If we move superior to the medulla oblongata, we have the pontine respiratory centers, and in pons we have two separate centers, one in the upper pons, that is the pneumotaxis center, and the other one just inferior to the pneumotaxis center is apneustic center. Both pneumotaxis and apneustic pontine respiratory centers are superior to the medullary centers. Another group of neuron or collection of neurons is located between the pontine and medullary respiratory centers. Here you can see this group of neuron or collection of neuron is known as the pre-Bortzinger complex. We can classify this pre-Bortzinger complex as a separate respiratory center located inside the medulla, or sometimes we can classify pre-Bortzinger complex as a type of VRG, because it is located adjacently to the ventral respiratory group of neurons. So pre-Bortzinger complex can be classified separately as one of the medullary centers, or sometimes it can be classified as a subcomponent of ventral respiratory group of neurons. So again, you can see the cut section, the dorsal respiratory group of neuron, the first of the two medullary respiratory centers. Then we have the ventral respiratory group of neuron, the second of the medullary centers. And superior to the medullary centers, we have pontine centers, pneumotaxic and apneustic. One located superiorly and inferior to the pneumotaxic is the apneustic center. So this is the location of these respiratory centers. Now, what are the functions of these respiratory centers? We will discuss one by one, starting from the dorsal respiratory group of neurons. As we all know, this group of neurons is located within the medulla oblongata, and the primary function of this center is to control the inspiration. So inspiration is controlled by the DRG, or dorsal respiratory group of neurons. And how does it control the inspiration? By producing certain ramp signals. These are known as inspiratory ramp signals. And what are inspiratory ramp signals? These are excitatory signals or rhythmic signals generated by the dorsal respiratory group of neurons so that the inspiration is increased progressively. So whenever inspiration is done, it increases in a progressive manner rather than a sudden process. And these rhythmical inspiratory signals, which increase in intensity progressively, is known as inspiratory ramp signals. So there is role of BRG in generation of inspiratory ramp signals so that inspiration is done in a rhythmical progressive manner rather than a sudden process. The counterpart is ventral respiratory group of neuron. Although the function is dual, BRG controls both expiration as well as inspiration, but there is dominant role of BRG over expiration. So during normal quiet breathing, the ventral respiratory group of neurons are usually in a dormant state. So during quiet inspiration or expiration, the DRG, dorsal respiratory group of neurons, are in active state. Ventral respiratory group of neurons, they remain in a dormant state or in an inactive state during normal quiet breathing. However, when you perform some strenuous exercise or some physical activity, signals from the DRG spill over to the ventral respiratory group of neurons. This means this group of neurons, the VRG, it becomes active usually during physical exertion, especially during strenuous exercise. Although ventral respiratory group of neurons control both expiration phase and inspiration phase, but predominantly it controls the expiration. So, role of DRG in control of inspiration by generation of inspiratory ramp signals. And then there is role of ventral respiratory group of neurons in expiration, especially during exercise. Another important factor which controls the rhythmical activity of dorsal respiratory group of neuron is the control from the pontine centers. Here you can see this is the pneumotaxic center, which is located in the superior part of pons. This pneumotaxic center, it sends an inhibitory signal to the dorsal respiratory group of neurons. This dotted line here, this dotted line indicates that this is sending an inhibitory signal to the DRG. So when pneumotaxic centers get activated, they will send an inhibitory signal to the DRG, and this will limit the inspiratory ramp signals or limit the ability of DRG to generate further inspiratory ramp signals. Remember, the dorsal respiratory group of neuron, they are located in the nucleus of tractus solitarius. You must have heard this name, commonly known as NTS, nucleus of tractus solitarius. So inside the medulla oblongata, we have this nucleus of tractus solitarius where the DRG centers are located. The ventral respiratory group of neurons are located within the same medulla oblongata, but the nuclei are different. And these are the nucleus ambiguous and nucleus retroambiguous. So for DRG, the name of the nucleus is nucleus of tractus solitarius. For VRG, we have nucleus ambiguous and nucleus retroambiguous. Both are the medullary nuclei. As far as pneumotaxic center is concerned, It is located in the nucleus parabrachialis. And from this nucleus parabrachialis, the neurotaxic center sends inhibitory signals downwards to the DRG. So these are the components of the medullary centers, the dorsal respiratory group of neurons, the first of the two medullary centers. It is located in the dorsal medulla. The major component is the nucleus of tractus solitarius. And the dominant role of DRG is during the inspiratory phase, especially during normal quiet breathing. So when you are in a quiet state or when you are doing no physical activity, the DRG are the dominant ones and they will generate inspiratory ramp signals to control the inspiration phase. Now we can divide the ventral respiratory group of neurons into three components. The ventral respiratory group of neurons are also located within the same medulla, but we can subdivide into rostral component, intermediate component, and caudal component. And here you can see the role of VRG in both expiratory phase as well as in inspiratory phase. And you can see the location. They are located in the nucleus ambiguous and nucleus retroambiguous. So nucleus ambiguous controls the inspiratory phase and nucleus retroambiguous controls the expiratory phase. Remember, although the ventral respiratory group of neurons, they regulate both inspiration as well as expiration, but the dominant role of VRG is during the expiratory phase, especially during physical activity or strenuous exercise. So when you perform physical activity or strenuous exercise, signals from the DRG will spill to the ventral respiratory group of neurons. Usually during normal quiet breathing, the VRG is in a dormant state or in an inactive state. But during physical exercise, some of the signals from the dorsal respiratory group of neurons are spilled over to the VRG. And now the VRG is in active state. And this will control the expiration phase. So to summarize, there are two medullary respiratory centers, dorsal respiratory group of neurons and ventral respiratory group of neurons. Both are located in the dorsal medulla and ventral medulla respectively. The dorsal respiratory group of neurons are located within the nucleus of tractus solitarius, which controls the generation of inspiratory ramp signals, whereas ventral respiratory group of neurons are usually inactive during normal quiet breathing. However, during physical activity, some of the signals from DRG, they are spilled over to the ventral respiratory group of neurons, and this will activate the ventral respiratory center. And there is a predominant role of VRG during the expiratory phase. Although expiration is a passive process, but still, there is role of the ventral respiratory group of neurons. Remember the location for DRG, nucleus of tractus solitarius, and for VRG, nucleus ambiguous and retroambiguous. So in the previous diagram here, we discussed another center located inside the medulla, the pre-Bodzinger complex. Now we can either classify this medullary pre-Bodzinger complex as a separate group of neurons, or sometimes we can say that this is a part of VRG because it is placed adjacently to the ventral respiratory group of neurons. So sometimes we can classify the pre-Bodzinger complex as one of the components of the VRG. and there is role of this pre-Botzinger complex during the inspiratory phase. So although VRG plays its part during inspiration as well as during expiration, but the dominant role is during the expiratory phase, especially during exercise. Again, you can see the location of the pre-Botzinger complex here. This is the location of pre-Botzinger complex on either side of the medulla. This blue region is the area of pre-Botzinger complex. So they are located bilaterally. So they are located bilaterally on either side between the nucleus ambiguus and the lateral reticular nucleus. So this is the lateral reticular nucleus, and here you can see the nucleus ambiguus. So in between the nucleus ambiguus and lateral reticular nucleus, we have the pre-Botzinger complex. Now this pre-Botzinger complex is responsible for the automatic control of respiration. So it contains special type of cells that have intrinsic ability to generate electrical potential, just like the SA node of the heart, which is known as the pacemaker of the cardiac muscle. Similar pacemaker activity is exhibited by this pre-Botzinger complex. Here you can see the pacemaker activity of this pre-Botzinger complex. So this is responsible for generation of rhythmical potential. So here you can see, so this is the indigenous ability or intrinsic ability of the pre-Botzinger complex to produce rhythmical discharges, especially during the inspiratory phase. So this is the summary. We have just discussed the medullary respiratory center. So we are here within the medulla oblongata. We have discussed the dorsal respiratory group of neurons and the ventral respiratory group of neurons. The dorsal respiratory group of neurons are in the dorsum medulla, and the nucleus is nucleus of tractus solitarius. Remember the name of the nucleus for DRG, nucleus of tractus solitarius. Now this nucleus of tractus solitarius will receive afferent nerve fibers from two important cranial nerves, and these cranial nerves are 9 and 10 cranial nerves, glossopharyngeal and vagus. So this is the input of the DRG. So the input comes from cranial nerve 9 and cranial nerve 10, glossopharyngeal nerve and vagus nerve. So once the nucleus tractus solitarius receives this input from the glossopharyngeal and vagus cranial nerve, then this signal will be sent to the peripheral chemoreceptors, and this signal will be sent via the phrenic nerve. So this is the output. Remember, the output for the DRG is phrenic nerve, and this is the nerve which innervates the diaphragm. So input is via the 9th and 10th cranial nerve. The center is in the nucleus of tractus solitarius, and the efferent fibers, they supply the diaphragm via phrenic nerve. Remember the role of DRG in inspiration, and how does it control inspiration? By producing, by generation of inspiratory ramp signals. So remember the word inspiratory ramp signals. So during the inspiratory phase, the inspiration is increased progressively. Adjacently placed to the DRG, we have the other, the counterpart, ventral respiratory group of neurons. And this ventral respiratory group of neurons is responsible for the control of expiration. Remember the dominant role in expiratory phase. Remember, this VRG is inactive during the normal quiet breathing. So, can you hear me now? Please text me. Can you hear me? This is Dr. Haseeb. Students, can you hear me? Okay, fine. So we are back. So we were discussing the role of the medullary centers, the DRG and VRG. We have discussed the dominant role of DRG during the inspiration and then dominant role of VRG during the expiration. So during normal quiet breathing, the ventral respiratory group of neurons, they remain inactive. But when you perform physical exercise, strenuous exercise, signals from the DRG will be spilled to the ventral respiratory group. And this will activate the VRG. So role of dorsal respiratory group of neuron during inspiration, role of ventral respiratory group of neuron during expiration. Remember, the input comes from the vagus and glossopharyngeal nerve to the DRG, and the output is via the phrenic nerve to the diaphragm. So we are done with this medullary respiratory center. Now we will move superiorly towards the pons. And there are two pontine centers as well. One is the pneumotaxis center located in the upper pons here. This is the pneumotaxis center. And inferior to the pneumotaxis center is another center, apneustic center. Now, what is this apneustic center? This is required for apneusis. And what is apneusis? Production of prolonged deep inspiratory gasps is known as apneusis. So apneusis will stimulate inspiration. This will stimulate inspiration. This is located in the lower pons. And superior to the apneustic center is the pneumotaxis center in the upper pons. Remember, a pneumotaxis center will inhibit inspiration. Remember the role of pneumotaxis center. It always sends inhibitory signal to the DRG. So this is the pneumotaxis center here. And this is the dorsal respiratory group of neuron here. So this will send inhibitory signal to the DRG. Remember, the signal sent via the pneumotaxis center is always inhibitory. This minus sign indicates inhibitory signal. So this will inhibit all the functions of DRG, and the DRG will not be able to generate rhythmical inspiratory ramp signals. So when the DRG becomes inhibited, this will decrease the depth of respiration, or you can say the volume of inspiration will be decreased. So decrease in the inspiration depth or decrease in the inspiratory volume. So when the depth of respiration is compromised, this will increase the breathing rate as a compensatory effect. So this is the role of pneumotaxis center. It inhibits the DRG by sending inhibitory signals. Once the DRG gets inhibited, this will decrease the inspiratory volume and the respiratory rate, the breathing rate will increase. So I have a question. Is the stimulus for respiratory activity comes from the pre-Bodzinger complex or from medulla? Okay. Which stimulus? Pre-Bodzinger complex is a separate complex here located in the medulla. So pre-Bodzinger complex is located within the medulla oblongata. The pneumotaxis center is located in the pons. So these are two different group of neurons. Remember, pre-Bodzinger complex is located bilaterally within the medulla oblongata. We are discussing about pneumotaxis center. Pneumotaxis center is located in the pons. and this will send inhibitory signal to the dorsal respiratory group of neuron. Once the DRG is inhibited, this will compromise the inspiratory volume. The dominant role, remember, the dominant role of DRG in generation of inspiratory ramp signals. So when the ramp signals will not be generated, the inspiratory volume will fall. And as a compensatory effect, the breathing rate will increase. So this is the role of pneumotaxis center in limiting the inspiration. As far as the pre-Bodzinger complex is concerned, pre-Bodzinger complex is located bilaterally on either side of the medulla oblongata between the lateral reticular nucleus and nucleus ambiguus. And we can sometimes classify pre-Bodzinger complex as a subcomponent of VRG. Subcomponent of VRG. Now this pre-Bodzinger complex has a role during the inspiratory phase. How? By generation of rhythmical oscillatory discharges. So these are the pacemaker cells for the automatic control of respiration, especially during inspiration. So we are done with the medullary respiratory centers. We have discussed the DRG, VRG, and the pre-Bodzinger complex, the three medullary respiratory centers, and the two pontine respiratory centers, the pneumotaxis and apneustic center. All these respiratory centers, whether medullary or pontine, they are regulated to certain degree by the voluntary control from the higher center, that is signal from the cerebrum. So we can voluntarily increase or decrease our respiration. We can voluntarily hold our breath for a few seconds, for a few minutes, by the signal coming from the cerebrum. So there is some role of cerebral cortex in the voluntary control. So we can voluntarily hypoventilate. We can voluntarily hold our breath for some time, or we can voluntarily hyperventilate. Right? So these are the respiratory centers. The respiratory control centers are located within the medulla oblongata as well as in the pons. We have discussed the medullary respiratory centers and how these medullary respiratory centers are controlled by pontine centers. And then we discussed the regulation of both medullary and pontine by the cerebral cortex. So this is the cut section of the posterior view of the brainstem. Here you can see the medullary centers. Here you can see the location of dorsal respiratory group of neurons. Can you spot the DRG? This is the dorsal respiratory group of neuron here. And on the ventral surface, these are the ventral respiratory group of neuron. Both are located within the medulla oblongata, one towards the posterior or dorsal end, one towards the anterior or the ventral end. The name of the nucleus for DRG is nucleus of tractus solitarius, NTS. And the two important nuclei for VRG are nucleus ambiguus or nucleus retroambiguous. And we can include the pre-Bodzinger complex as a subcomponent of VRG as well. So this is the location of the medullary centers. Now if we move superiorly, this is medulla oblongata. This is medulla oblongata from here to here. This is medulla. Superior to it is pons. This is the line of demarcation. Here, this is the fourth ventricle in the middle. And this is the pontine region. Colliculus and pons. This is the location of pneumotaxis center. Remember, this NPBL stands for Sorry for the interruption. So we have discussed the dorsal respiratory group of neuron and the ventral respiratory group of neuron. This is the fourth ventricle, and superior to the medulla oblongata we have pons. And here is the location of nucleus parabrachialis, which is located within the pneumotaxis center. Remember the role of pneumotaxis center. If you remember, this pneumotaxis center sends inhibitory signals. So inhibitory signals will be sent where? To the DRG. So this will send inhibitory signals to the dorsal respiratory group of neuron, and this will limit the inspiratory rate. The inspiratory volume will be compromised, the depth of breathing will be compromised, and the breathing rate will increase. Now these are the effects on the spirogram of different levels of lesion. So if you transect the brainstem at the level D here, whether the vagus nerve is intact or damaged, no breathing will be there. So absolute cessation of breathing if the level of transection is here at the level of brainstem, at the level of brainstem D. So no breathing rate, whether the vagus nerve is intact or damaged. Now, if the level of lesion is near the pneumotaxis center at point B, so if the lesion is at point B, this will damage the pneumotaxis center and this will damage the nucleus parabrachialis. And can you see the apneusis? This is the apneusis. So when the vagus nerve is damaged, this prolonged deep inspiration, this prolonged deep inspiration is known as apneusis. So back to the same flow chart. Voluntary control is done by the cerebral cortex. We have covered the dorsal respiratory group of neurons and the ventral respiratory group of neurons. Both are the medullary respiratory centers. And we have discussed the pneumotaxis center and the pontine center. Both are the centers for pons. So this is the respiratory control centers. Now this respiratory control center is not only regulated by the cerebral cortex, but there are other types of receptors known as chemoreceptors. And these chemoreceptors, once activated, will affect the medullary and pontine centers as well. And we can classify these chemoreceptors as central chemoreceptors, number one, or peripheral chemoreceptors, number two. Remember, the central chemoreceptors are located inside the same brain stem where the DRG and the VRG are located. These central chemoreceptors are located within the same medulla oblongata, but these are different types of receptors. These are for chemical control of respiration. The DRG and the VRG, these are for the neural control of respiration. If you remember the first slide, we discussed the regulation of respiration is done by two mechanisms, neural mechanism or nervous mechanism, and the second is chemical mechanism. Remember, the medullary and pontine centers, the DRG or VRG, the medullary centers, these centers are for neural control or nervous mechanism. We have specific separate receptors known as central chemoreceptors for the chemical control of respiration. Although these central chemoreceptors are located within the same medulla oblongata, but these are different types of receptors. The stimulus is different. The mechanism of action is different as well. So central chemoreceptors are located near the floor of the fourth ventricle inside the medulla oblongata. And besides these central chemoreceptors, we have arterial receptors or peripheral chemoreceptors as well. These peripheral chemoreceptors are also known as arterial chemoreceptors. Why arterial chemoreceptors? They are located at the junction of the arteries, big arteries, the carotid arteries and the aortic artery. So now we are done with the medullary respiratory control center and the pontine respiratory control center. These are responsible for the nervous regulation or nervous control of breathing. So we are done with this part. Now we will move to the chemical control of respiration. And for chemical control, we have chemoreceptors, whether central chemoreceptors of the medulla or peripheral chemoreceptors of carotid or aortic arteries. So we have two types of chemoreceptors, peripheral chemoreceptors and central chemoreceptors. Central, as the name indicates, is in the center or the brain stem, especially inside the medulla oblongata. So central chemoreceptors are located close to the fourth ventricle, floor of fourth ventricle inside the medulla oblongata. This is the location for central chemoreceptor. And the most important stimulus for activation of central chemoreceptor is hydrogen ions. I repeat, the most important stimulus for the control of central chemoreceptor is variation in hydrogen ion or variation in pH value. So decrease in pH value or increase in PCO2. Decrease in pH means increased concentration of hydrogen ions. So if the concentration of hydrogen ions or the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, if any of these two factors increase, this will activate the central chemoreceptors located in the medulla oblongata. Then we have peripheral chemoreceptors, and these peripheral chemoreceptors are located peripherally within the carotid and aortic bodies. And the important point to remember is that the most important stimulus for activation of peripheral chemoreceptor is the partial pressure of oxygen. So drop in PO2 will activate the peripheral chemoreceptor. Remember, drop in pH will activate the central chemoreceptor. Drop in PO2 will activate the peripheral chemoreceptor. This peripheral chemoreceptor can also be activated by increased PCO2 or increase in hydrogen ion concentration, but the primary stimulus is fall in arterial pressure, partial pressure of oxygen, less than 60 millimeters of mercury. Remember the primary stimulus for peripheral chemoreceptors. The primary stimulus is fall in PO2 less than 60 millimeters mercury. And the primary stimulus for activation of central chemoreceptor is drop in pH, or you can say increase in hydrogen ion concentration or increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. So these are the two types of chemoreceptors, central and peripheral. Central are located inside the medulla oblongata near the floor of fourth ventricle. And these central chemoreceptors are activated by either drop in pH or by increased PCO2. Then the peripheral chemoreceptors are located inside the carotid and aortic bodies. And the primary stimulus for activation of peripheral chemoreceptor is fall in PO2 less than 60 millimeters of mercury. Now this is the response of the chemoreceptors to variation in either PO2 or PCO2. Remember, central chemoreceptors, they respond to change in PCO2. C for central, C for CO2. So remember, central are for CO2 and peripheral chemoreceptors are for variation in oxygen level. So drop in oxygen level, especially drop less than 60 millimeters mercury, will activate the peripheral chemoreceptor, and rise in PCO2 will activate the central chemoreceptor. So once the PCO2 is above normal, this will activate the central chemoreceptors located inside the medulla oblongata. And this will cause hyperventilation. So when the carbon dioxide levels are on the higher side, central chemoreceptors will cause the person to hyperventilate. By hyperventilation, we are blowing out more carbon dioxide out of the body. So this will bring the carbon dioxide level back to the normal level. On the other hand, the peripheral chemoreceptors will become activated when there is drop in the PO2. So drop in PO2 will activate the peripheral chemoreceptors. Now, the decision is whether this drop is less than 60 millimeters mercury or not. If the drop in PO2 is less than 60 millimeters mercury, this will immediately cause hyperventilation. Remember, when the partial pressure of oxygen is less than 60 millimeters mercury, these peripheral chemoreceptors are extremely sensitive. I repeat, these peripheral chemoreceptors become extremely sensitive when the PO2 falls below 60 millimeters mercury. Now, why there is hypersensitivity of peripheral chemoreceptors when the PO2 falls below 60 millimeters mercury? We will discuss the concept when we will discuss the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. If you remember the plateau phase of oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, so 60 millimeter mercury is the cutoff point. And here you can see the location of the peripheral chemoreceptors. These are the carotid bodies here. These red spots are the carotid bodies. And here are the aortic bodies. Since these receptors, both carotid bodies and aortic bodies, are located within the arteries, whether carotid artery or aortic artery, that is the reason we can also call them as arterial chemoreceptors. So peripheral chemoreceptors are located at the carotid bodies as well as the aortic bodies. And this is the region for the carotid sinus here. Now, what is the difference between carotid sinus and carotid body? So carotid body is at the bifurcation of the common carotid artery. Remember, carotid body is at the bifurcation of common carotid artery. And this is the bifurcation here. This T junction is the bifurcation of common carotid. This is the left common carotid artery and this is the right common carotid artery. And each left and right common carotid artery bifurcates into two carotid arteries. And at the junction of the common carotid artery, the carotid bodies are located. Whereas the carotid sinus is a spindle-shaped dilatation located at the origin of the internal carotid artery. This is the junction of the origin of internal carotid artery. So the carotid sinus is the dilatation at the origin of internal carotid artery. Remember, carotid sinus is one of the examples of baroreceptor, also known as pressoreceptor. So baroreceptor is a type of mechanoreceptor and this will detect any change in pressure. So any change in arterial pressure will be sensed, will be detected by the carotid sinus. If you remember the carotid sinus syndrome. So this is the difference between carotid sinus, which acts as a baroreceptor located at the origin of internal carotid artery, and the carotid body. Carotid body is a chemoreceptor located at the bifurcation of common carotid artery. So the sinus acts as
a baroreceptor. The body, carotid body, acts as a chemoreceptor. And for chemoreceptor, the stimulus is obviously of chemical nature, whether deficiency of oxygen or excessive carbon dioxide or hydrogen ion concentration. So increase in carbon dioxide, increase in hydrogen ion, or decrease in oxygen, any of these three chemical stimuli will activate the carotid body chemoreceptor. So we will stop here. We will continue from here tomorrow, inshallah. So to summarize, we have discussed the role of the respiratory control centers, the two important medullary respiratory centers, dorsal respiratory group of neuron and ventral respiratory group of neuron. The dorsal respiratory group of neurons are predominantly active during the inspiratory phase by producing inspiratory ramp signals. The nucleus is nucleus of tractus solitarius, which receives the input via the 9th and 10th cranial nerve, and the output to diaphragm is via the phrenic nerve. Whereas the ventral respiratory group of neuron is primarily involved in expiration. This group of neurons remains inactive during the normal quiet breathing, but becomes active during exercise. And these medullary centers are activated or regulated by the pontine centers, pneumotaxis, and apneustic center. The apneustic center is responsible for sending inhibitory signals to DRG. Hence, it compromises the inspiratory volume and increases the respiratory rate. Besides these medullary and pontine respiratory control centers, we have specific chemoreceptors as well. The chemoreceptors located in the medulla are central, and the chemoreceptors located in the carotid bodies and the aortic bodies are peripheral. So we will stop here, inshallah. We will continue. We will resume our discussion from the peripheral chemoreceptor tomorrow, inshallah. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.